Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We have here with us today two gentlemen from Freetown, Sierra Leone. They are here with a flagship project of the government of Sierra Leone. I have on my left-hand side Mr. Amara O Kuyateh, he's the Deputy Director General of NASSIT. And then on my right-hand side is Mr. Joe Hassan Kalokoh, he's the Head of Research, Planning and the Actuarial Division of NASSIT. Now, we're going to welcome, gentlemen.
Thank
First
you.
First of all, Mr. Kuyateh, you are the Deputy Director General of NASSIT. What is NASSIT?
Okay, NASSIT is an acronym for the National Social Security Insurance Trust. It was formed by the passage of the NASSIT Act No. 5 of 2001. NASSIT started its operations in 2002. And NASSIT is 13 years old at the moment. Compared to the NASSIT equivalents in the United States, the Social Security Administration, which is 80 years old. So compared to other institutions, even in the sub-region, we are a relatively young institution. We are charged with the responsibility of managing the nation's pension scheme.
Okay, so Mr. Kuyateh, can you give us a little spotlight on your background?
Okay. With regards to my professional and academic background, I studied in the United Kingdom. I hold a BA honours in Banking and Financial Services from the City University of Birmingham in the UK. I hold a Master's degree in International Money, Finance and Investments. And I worked in the UK for about 2 years after grad school in the Department of the Environment, Transport and the Regions as a management account supervisor. And then I moved to the United States in 2001. And I spent about 14 years in public accounting. I worked for PricewaterhouseCoopers for 6 years. Grant Thornton LLP as a senior manager for 3 years, and then last year I returned to Sierra Leone after serving as a partner in Watson Rice LLP, a public accounting firm headquartered in New York City, but I actually walked out of the Washington DC office. I hold about 6 professional qualifications that range from accounting, public and project management, and information technology.
Okay, that's an impressive array of qualifications and experience for the kind of job you're doing. Okay, I'll come to you later. On my right-hand side is Mr. Joe Hassan Kalokoh. As I said earlier, he's the head of the Research, Planning and Material Division of NASSIT. Mr. Kalokoh, do you mind telling us about your qualifications and experience?
Well, I'm a researcher. Actually, I hold several qualifications ranging from economics, statistics, and actuarial science. See, this now I am the head of research, planning, and actuarials. Very soon I will be a full actuary. But I got my qualification from different countries, from the UK, Mauritius, and Australia. Now, I used to work for Bank of Sierra Leone, and now I'm working for NASSIT. In a short time, I worked with Pricewaterhouse in the UK. But as far as my job now is concerned, I am involved with my team in ensuring that every policy NASSIT is taking is thoroughly screened, and we help develop them, push them. We're in charge of planning when it comes to even investment aspects. We make sure that we scrutinize all investments before they are even undertaken. And we receive very full support from my boss, Mr. Kuyateh.
As you can see, we have two gentlemen here who are well experienced and who are well educated. This goes to show that the government of Sierra Leone does not put square pegs in round holes, as some dissident elements would like you to believe. From what they have said, you can see that they are well educated and they have the experience that is adapted to the kind of work they are doing. So now we go on to the real purpose of the interview. They are here in the US. They've been here for 2 weeks, right? For about 2 weeks. So what is the purpose of your what are the purposes and objectives of your outreach?
Okay. This is the first outreach mission by NASSIT to the United States. NASSIT has been in existence for 13 years, but in country and more so out of the country, our Sierra Leonean communities are not familiar about the programs and the NASSIT scheme. So our visit here is twofold. First of all, to tell them about what we're currently doing, and secondly, what we plan to do in the future and how they can be engaged and how they can participate in the NASSIT scheme. But we are also here with our subsidiary, which is Home Mortgage and Finance Company, NASSIT, which is a 98.4% equity-owned institution. They sell mortgage products, and at the moment they do housing community projects, and we want to tell the Sierra Leonean community about these products and how they can buy some of these products. Ultimately, we want Sierra Leoneans in the US to know that NASSIT and the NASSIT scheme is for all Sierra Leoneans, irrespective of whether you're living in country or whether you're living overseas. You may still be able, if you so wish, to get a NASSIT social security account and contribute monies to your account on a monthly basis. And with regards to the HFC mortgage scheme, as long as you're Sierra Leonean and at least 18 years old or between the age of 18 to 60, you can participate or buy some of these HFC products.
So that's very good. That's a laudable mission, which I believe will benefit Sierra Leoneans. What states have you visited to?
Well, our inaugural town hall meeting was in the Maryland area, in Silver Spring. And after that, that was on the 10th of October, we held the second meeting in Atlanta, Georgia on the 17th. We went on to Columbus, Ohio on the 18th. And as a result, due to popular demand in the Maryland area, we held a second town hall meeting in Maryland on Wednesday, the 21st of October. And then finally, yesterday, we held a town hall meeting in New Jersey, in Somerset, New Jersey.
Now, what was the reaction of the Union outreach?
Well, the reaction has been very positive because we were able to address some of their concerns, and we were able to tell them about the NASSIT scheme, which even as much as NASSIT has been in existence for 13 years, but you will be shocked as to how even highly educated Sierra Leoneans know very little about the NASSIT scheme. So we were able to inform, we were able to clarify, and we were able to articulate explanations of some controversial issues.
Okay, I noticed from witnessing one of the programs yesterday that we had a package, quite an impressive package for Sierra Leoneans. Do you mind telling our listeners some of these packages you have?
Okay, on the NASSIT side, we currently have three contingencies. We offer old age pension. When you retire after the age of 60, you get a monthly pension. It is a defined benefits plan. We have what is called a survivor's benefit. If you die, your dependents, your wife and kids can get a benefit, a survivor's benefit. And if you're disabled permanently whilst working, you may get disability benefits. And also, we are currently working on the social health insurance scheme. When that is fully implemented, if you're working in Sierra Leone and you get sick, you will get health insurance if you are enrolled in the social health insurance scheme offered by NASSIT. So these are all benefits you can get if you are enrolled on the NASSIT scheme, even if you're living overseas. On the HFC side, they offer mortgage products. They have the traditional mortgage, wherein if you have a house, they can help with the financing. But they also have what is called a home completion loan, where because our people build their homes in an incremental manner, if you've completed the house up to the roof level, you can get a loan for almost 70% of the value of the house to complete the loan. And then finally, they have these products themselves. They're working in collaboration with other builders, wherein they actually build the homes, and you can buy some of these homes. At the moment, they have 12, the first phase of a housing project in Bathurst, Freetown, where they're building three-bedroom detached bungalow-style house for $75,000, and they're building about 30 homes in Gloucester that range two-bedroom and three-bedroom homes from $48,000 to $60,000. And these are some of the products they have on offer. At the moment, they've sold 9 out of the 12 homes in Bathurst, and they're looking to build more homes, and they're looking for Sierra Leoneans to know and hopefully be interested in buying some of these products.
So, are Sierra Leoneans satisfied with these houses? Do these houses meet their expectations?
Absolutely. These are like estate-style homes. They are modeled in line with the current NASSIT homes that we have in Goderich, where the roads are paved, the landscaping and the ambience of the community is up to, I will even bother or venture to say, world-class standards. It is a very modern housing estate with modern facilities.
So listeners, as you can see, this is what I would describe as a bonanza for Sierra Leone. When you consider the problems that we have in the diaspora, with the question of trust and distrust, which I'm going to come to later on. Now I go on to Mr. Joe Hassan Kalokoh. I said earlier that he's the head of the research, planning and actuarial division of NASSIT. Mr. Kalokoh, what lessons have you learned from this trip?
Thank you, Mr. Kabs-kanu. We've really learned some very fundamental lessons from this, I could call it exploration, because we started just about 13 years ago, and our neighboring countries like Ghana, Liberia, you know, even the Gambia, they've been in this social security stuff for over 20 years. So there is a lot more we have to learn, you know, to make sure that we become a formidable institution. But interestingly, we've come to realize over the years that, in fact, we are doing far better than most of these other countries now in terms of our delivery of service and the kind of products that we now offer as an institution. For these trips specifically, we've been, well, of course, for me, first of all, I underestimated this trip, but I come to realize that so much has happened within these 2 weeks, you know, whilst we are here, and I feel accomplished together with the Deputy Director General. We appreciate the fact that we are here because the kind of response we are having from Sierra Leoneans is just very much encouraging. Now, the point here is ISSA, which is the International Social Security Association, and the ILO, which is the International Labour Organization, they are encouraging every social security institution globally to make sure that they design strategies as to how they can be able to reach out to their citizens living elsewhere, those people that in their country that have migrated in search of jobs elsewhere. Because social security, we must note, is a fundamental human right. It's something that every citizen of a country needs to understand that it is their right, and it is the responsibility of every government, every country, to make sure that their citizens are covered, are fully covered as far as social protection is concerned. And interestingly, it is enshrined in our national constitution. So we do not take that lightly. When a resolution was passed very recently, a few years, by the ILO and ESA, with regards to chasing migrant workers, we are taking the first bold step to make sure that we go after Sierra Leoneans anywhere they live. One, to investigate the extent of social security coverage they are enjoying, which is very, very important. We've been to the Gambia before, we realized that there are so many problems citizens, Sierra Leoneans are facing. And we attempted to address those problems, trying to meet even the Social Security Administration there to see how we can exchange ideas and try to see how we can protect our citizens. In the United States, after the first meeting we were able to meet with the Social Security Administration in the United States here, and we were able to learn firsthand as to what are the contingencies, what are the benefits that they cover. And we are so pleased and we felt so proud that, in fact, by comparison, our scheme is much more generous as compared to theirs. And the principles that we apply are not far away from what they do. So, I mean, in fact, to some extent, some of the things, when we explain to them how we administer our scheme, they feel impressed, you know. So we are able to learn from their experience. We are able to understand some of the things we need to borrow from them and apply them so that we can make our scheme a better one. The other thing that we learned from this trip is the fact that there are Sierra Leoneans that started working in Sierra Leone and they were a registered member of NASSIT, but they have moved over to this country. These people, all throughout this period in their stay in the US, they were worried and concerned about their membership with NASSIT. So until now that we are here, we have explained to them, they have come forward, and we are able to solve their problems. There are so many problems they have, ranging from not having a social security number, a social security card, but the employer had been deducting their monies, you know, before they come here, in short of jobs. So we are able to address their problems, we are able to catalog all of these problems, and we will take them home. There's a lot of them than I would have ever imagined, you know. And also, as you know, as a scheme, we are facing some problems. Some of them, during the meetings, the town hall meetings, we are able to meet with entrepreneurs, Sierra Leone entrepreneurs, YZs, very formidable individuals that have got experience from various their places of work in the US. Now, during the exchange of ideas, we are able to learn a lot. I've been able to, you know, as a researcher, anything that I come across, I always want to benefit out of it, to catch knowledge, to learn from other people's experience. And really, I've been able to benefit from a lot of ideas that have been brought forward by those specific individuals that were able to attend the meetings. And we are very grateful for their wisdom, for their knowledge, for their, the information they made available to us, for their guide. They are passionate to see that Sierra Leone moves ahead. So I have cataloged those new brilliant ideas. We'll take them home with us, you know. And lastly, I think this is a step that we will take further. Because as it is now, well, I will not want to waste time in noting that the Sierra Leone Embassy in the US has done a very brilliant job for us. They assisted us in making sure that we are able to really make this trip a success. So there are so many other new ideas that we think we will make sure that we continue to push this this idea of going after Sierra Leoneans in the diaspora.
That's very good. It sounds very impressive. As you can agree with me, this shows how much the government of Sierra Leone is trying to address the welfare of the people, because social protection is an issue that have been bothering many Sierra Leoneans, because many want to go back home after spending their time in the diaspora. But they have been worried about how socially they will be protected in their country. So this is a marvelous program you two gentlemen came to perform in the U.S. And then now the other question I want to ask you, also Mr. Kalokoh, within NASSIT itself, do you have any operational challenges?
So many of them. Like I told you earlier, NASSIT is a new scheme. We started barely 13 years ago. And as it is always the case, when you have a new institution being introduced, a new phenomenon in the country, you have to grow over time. There are stages, phases, and in each of those phases, there are numerous challenges. The idea of social security is new in Sierra Leone. Interestingly, I will tell you, one of the biggest problems we faced, even at the inception of the scheme, is the low literacy rate in the country. It's a big challenge. As compared to the US here, everything is computerized. In Sierra Leone, most often, you know, even those people that are in the formal sector, we have problems in trying to let them understand what social security is all about. You know, so you have a situation where even in terms of given their age, some of them, they don't know their actual age. People don't know their real age. Sometimes they guess. And in the end, they come to realize that, in fact, this program is so important that they will have given their real age, you know. So this problem that started from the inception, of course, if you complete a social security form and you give wrong information, it will empty into the end of the entire process itself, that when it comes to payment of benefits. Some people will be working in their offices, especially in the government. They give one age. When you approach them, they think, oh, this is a programmer. They have their real age. They have their official age and their real age. So the difference in this has been a problem for us. The second thing is the challenge of trust for state institutions. It's a challenge, you know, because the public is in short, the mindset is short that every institution that is government related, should be a bit questionable. So how you can be able to convince these people, to let them understand that this is something different, they have to take it very seriously, it is for their benefit, it is something that will profit them, you know, it is a real challenge, my brother. Unlike here, even when the scheme is mandatory, it moves me to the other challenge, that is what we call social security evasion, you know, we call tax evasion, you know. Employers, because of the low literacy, all of these, they are interrelated. When you have a workforce that is low in terms of education, the employer, they make use of this, you understand what I mean? Yeah. So what they do is that they find a way of evading the contributions. People will be working for them, in fact, to the extent that some of them will be deducting their money, but they are not turning over the contribution to the social security institution. Or some of them will begin to, in fact, incite their employees that, look, this is not a program that is important for you. So what happened at the end of the day? You know, you have a situation wherein the employee will connive with the employer for them to avoid paying social security contribution. How to go after this is a challenge for us. I don't want to go too deep into it because of time. Now, of course, contribution, social security contribution evasion is a problem for African countries. But the other problem we have is the size of the informal sector. It's a challenge also. You know, over 90% of the active workforce in Sierra Leone is in the informal sector. In other words, the formal sector makes up only less than 10% of the active workforce. So If our scheme as it is now, which is a defined benefit scheme, is perceived by the public as being more pro-public sector scheme, you have a situation wherein our extent of coverage will be limited. So coverage, which is a major issue for every social security institution globally, becomes our major challenge as well. How we can capture this type of people who make up a greater percentage of the active workforce. So, but in all of this, I must tell you that we are designing ways to address these challenges. As it is now, we are trying to undertake studies from different countries, how we can be able to design a very attractive scheme that can be, help us to capture the informal sector, right? So basically, these are some of the few challenges so far.
Okay, the question that comes begging, obviously, is what are you doing to address this problem of the lethargy attitude of people towards the NASSIT programs? Do you have a system of public education where you to enlighten them? Because some of these problems, as you have said, are probably caused by the fact that these people are not learned, they have not reached that level of education and sophistication to be able to understand this scheme. So you have a unit within your department.
Certainly, Mr. Kabs-kanu.
Public education.
Certainly.
Because these people have to be educated to know to understand this.
Certainly. I must add this. We have a very robust, well, we are trying to make it as robust as possible. Since it is now, we have a public affairs division. For that matter, we have a customer service unit. For this public affairs, but one thing that is very, very unique about our country is the fact that because of the level of literacy of the people, only a few people are able to read newspapers, because our medium of communication to this public, one, through the print media, through the, how we call it? Even going there, the print media and the
radio,
electronics radio. Media, and face-to-face, and So, but the question is, how many Sierra Leoneans are actually listening to the radio or the television? How many Sierra Leoneans can afford a television? You know, only those people in the urban areas and some other major cities. So you have that, we have that problem. So now it makes our job challenging. Now it increases our cost for administrating the scheme. We have to move physically and go into the hinterland to meet these people, to explain to them, to let them understand. We write all the time, public notices, we explain. In fact, every week we have several programs on the television in each of the regional headquarter towns. You know, we engage the radio stations. They are informing people as to what needs to be done for you to make your life comfortable as far as social security is concerned, how you can interact with us, how our doors are open to you. But still, because of the level of literacy, it remains a challenge. So the answer is yes, we have a formidable team. We have a strategic division that is actually handling this publicity. But nevertheless, we are still facing, but we will not relent. We are designing strategies every day to make sure that we overcome the challenge. And in terms of the aspect of evasion of contributions, of course, we are very aggressive now. We have a legal litigation department. We have lawyers between. We have the authority. We are supported by government to pursue cases of evasions, recalcitrant institutions that refuse to pay to turn over their social security institution. Contributions. So we chase them, and we are doing a lot to make sure that. And even during this Ebola, we are expecting that our contribution package will shrink because of the fact that a lot of institutions will have closed. But interestingly, because of the aggressive moves we are taking, we realize a situation wherein the turnover of contribution is increasing, and the number of indebted institutions to the institution, they are reducing, even though it's difficult, but we are making the effort. Though it is very costly, even when we are chasing those kind of things. You know? So we are making efforts everywhere. We have a formidable team now.
Okay. Well, I'm not sure that NASSIT is on top of the issues. Because you spoke about the question of trust and mistrust. You know, it's definitely an issue that I believe that you are facing. So I want to ask this question. What structures have the government put in place to ensure that this problem of trust and mistrust is solved and that the people's investment in NASSIT is safe?
Well, interestingly, NASSIT is not a direct government. It's a state institution. It's not a government, but I would say it's a Sierra Leone institution, a national institution. Each government that comes, well, it owns NASSIT. It's a baby for the country. That is why the structure of NASSIT in itself is tripartite in nature, in the sense that all walks of life, they participate. We have 14-man board of trustees, ranging from the government representatives. We have the financial sector being represented here. We have somebody from even Labour Congress, civil society, even the teachers, everybody, the forces, they are all represented in that board. So every decision that is being taken, it has to be in the interest of those bodies that those individuals represent, which is key. But it is not a state, but it's the government that underwrites the scheme. Yes, we agree about it, right? But it is every government's entity. So what is important here is the fact that the structure, NASSIT is structured in such a way that every investment that is to be undertaken has to go through several layers of authority. That is why sometimes I feel a bit saddened when I hear people thinking that NASSIT is an institution where you just go and take money. From all the institutions I've worked, I've come to realize that the structures, you know, laid out in NASSIT, they are so rigid. For one to be able to do something, you need to receive assent from every layer, you know. So I would say that the institution is structured in such a way that the people's money are protected. In addition to this, I would say that we have internal audit exercise going on every quarter. So 4 times a year, the scheme is being audited from internally. And every year, the scheme is being audited by external auditors, independent, you know. That's another thing. And in addition to that, every 3 years, we have what we call actuarial assessment of the scheme. These are people that are consultants from overseas that will come and perform what we call an actuarial assessment of the scheme. They look at it from all angles, trying to look at it from backwards and forward, even to the extent of looking at it from an actuarial perspective, 50 years ahead, what will happen to the scheme. And there are what we call minimum levels of requirement. I mean, some amount that is we should always maintain for investment. I must say this in closing, that we are only allowed to invest surplus funds. Every fund that is meant for the payment of benefit, like I've always said, they are not touched. Right? It is only for those funds that we do not need them now for payment of benefit. And the reason why we have to invest some of these funds is because, one, if somebody is paying contributions now, you're paying is a long-term defined benefit scheme. In other words, benefits are for the long time. So we have to consider the aspect of time value of money. We have to maintain the value of the funds that are being paid today so that we can pay them with the same value in tomorrow. So this is why we have to invest these funds, you know, so that we can be able to pay, you know, some, you know, the adequate benefits in future. Because when social security experts are warning that the basic thing social security institutions should never forget is, one, the aspect of adequacy. The payment you make to the beneficiary should be adequate enough to take care of the basic needs of those people. So we are much more concerned about it. I think I'll stop there.
Okay, that's very good. Very good. That's a good way to appeal to the customers, to the future customers, people who want to invest in the program, because there are people out there who are very negative. They come up with negative reports, but from what you have explained, we can see that there are structures in place to make sure that they are fear, that what they fear doesn't happen. Now, in this same vein, can you clarify? I want to say, also talk about this NASSIT fair. You want this NASSIT fair issue, that whenever you want to talk about this NASSIT program, people talk about writing in forums about this NASSIT fair issue. What is what?
Okay. The NASSIT ferry issue has been a very controversial issue over the years. What happened was, a couple of years ago, first of all, NASSIT is not in the business of buying and operating ferries or transportation. But what happened was, because we have available funds, sometimes we are approached to make impact investments or socially targeted investments. A couple of years ago, there was a football match between our soccer national team, the Leone Stars, versus the soccer team from Togo. So after the match at the Siakan Stevens Stadium, they were flying from Freetown to Lunge International Airport in a commercial helicopter service. Unfortunately, that helicopter crashed at the Lunge Airport and killed about 11 Togo nationals, including the Togolese Minister of Sports. This was like during the time of the late President Ahmad Tejan Kabba, who immediately fired his Minister of Transport and Aviation, Dr. Prince Adding, back then. So after that tragedy, people were looking to see how best NASSIT can intervene in the transportation sector and help with purchasing ferries to help with transporting people back and forth from Freetown to Lunge International Airport. So the then Director General of NASSIT, Mr. Edmund Coleman, stated that, you know, we don't know anything about ferries. So if you can form a committee that can go review and inspect ferries, we will pay for the ferries. So a group of people outside of NASSIT were sent in with, together with some NASSIT employees, to go inspect and buy some ferries in Europe. Obviously, as the story goes, the idea behind buying the ferries was good, but the execution was flawed. Later on, the anti-corruption departments investigated the whole ferry saga. Some people were fined, and today we still have the two ferries, which I must say are in even better shape than the two currently plying from Lunge to the Kisii terminal. But we still maintain that we are not in the business of operating ferries. So we're looking out for ferry operators or people who want to invest to take these ferries off our hands and operate them.
So these two ferries are still working?
Yes. Well, some are just minor defects and deficiencies. Yeah, but they can be seaworthy with very little investments. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's good that that also has been clarified. So I believe that many of our listeners will be satisfied with your explanation.
And let me just add to that.
Okay.
You see, viewers, I would like us to understand one thing. The environment in which we operate is not investment friendly. We have to understand this. We are doing our best to make it. It's not like here. It's, the mechanics are far different. We are trying, and error a lot of things. Some are investments, are economically targeted investments. Some of them are socially targeted investments. When we see a need, and we as the big funding institution in the country, sometimes we don't straightly look at the profits. We look at how much it will serve humanity, how much it will enhance the welfare of Sierra Leoneans, how much it will salvage a given problem. You know, so we will intervene, but not to the extent of risking the funds of contributors. We will never do that, even in the case of the ferry. Mm-hmm. But what is important is NASSIT has got several investments. The ferry is just one of them. And in our business, investment is just one element. It's just one area of our entire operation. We have several areas of operation. Our main reason that, you know, the reason for our existence, one is to collect contributions and pay benefits. So the aspect of investment is just a mitigating action. So basically, when we invest, you have large pool of investments, and one of them go bad. I mean, it is this one of them that the public is crying about. Because in all of this, we must realize that even as an individual, if you have several units of investment, one has to go bad. But I can assure you that most of our investments are doing very well.
And Mr. Kabs-kanu, on that vein, I must also expand on what Joe Kalokoh just said. We have over 13 subsidiaries, and we happen to own the only five-star hotel in the country at the moment, the Radisson Hotel, which is currently proving to be very profitable, and which has served our nation very well during the Ebola epidemic. Ban Ki-moon, the UN Secretary General, Margaret Wu, the Director General of the World Health Organization, foreign heads of states and all the dignitaries, the CDC doctors, this is where they've stayed over the last 12 or more months when they come to Freetown for Ebola-related meetings and conferences, or to even serve in the holding centers and Ebola treatment centers. So if it wasn't for the Radisson, it would have been problematic to find a suitable place for these people to stay. So, you know, not all social or impact investments have been negative. Some of them have been profitable and positive to Sierra Leonean society.
So, the second and last question is, how profitable is NASSIT really?
Okay. Our trust funds are very solvent, they're very healthy, and they're very sound. According to the last actuarial review for 2010, we have enough funds to pay benefits for the next 30 or 40 years. So at the moment, the demographics are in our favor. You have more people contributing, there are more people claiming benefits. But there is no problems with the solvency of our trust funds. But I fundamentally believe the NASSIT as an institution has to be strong, as strong as the Central Bank of Sierra Leone. The public trust cannot be in question. We need to earn and maintain the public trust. And that is what we're striving to achieve.
Mm-hmm. Okay, gentlemen, thank you very much for this interview.
You're welcome.
What party messages do you have for the people, people that you have spoken to? Some people, they didn't go to the meetings. Okay. So for those that they didn't go to the meetings,
okay,
what do you have to tell them?
Well, for me, I'll have to say that I know there are a lot of trust issues, but for a very young institution, 13 years old, we are contributing very positively to Sierra Leonean economy and Sierra Leone society. We have various investments in the hospitality sector. We own the Radisson, like I previously stated. We own the Kimbima Hotel, which is going to be managed by the Golden Tulip brand. We own a minority stake in the Hilton Hotel, currently under construction. We have a minority stake in Sierra Leone Commercial Bank, the Standard Chartered Bank, Roquel Commercial Bank, Ecobank International. We play a key role in the financial system in Sierra Leone. We have a very energetic and talented workforce. So I have great faith in the administration of NASSIT as a government scheme. And I believe, you know, with the increasing government public scrutiny and with the increasing move towards international best practices, NASSIT as an institution can only continue to grow from strength to strength.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kalokoh.
My message, my parting message, will be directed to three sets of our audience. One, to those Sierra Leoneans who were working in Sierra Leone, they started with NASSIT and they have moved over to the United States and they are worried about what will be the situation, their contributions. I want to assure you that your monies are safe and that you need to do something to continue, you know, contributing to the NASSIT scheme. And that at any point in time you go to Sierra Leone, you can always walk to our doors and with your social security number or evidence of you being a member of the NASSIT scheme, be assured that you will be treated nicely. The second set of people I would like to address are those people that have not been with NASSIT, have not been working, but are in the United States here. But they are not in a formal employment. Because if you're not in formal employment in the US here, there is every possibility that you may not be benefiting from their pension scheme when you would have reached the retirement age or something happens to you. I would like to open up our arms to you that we are designing a package for you. This is the essence of our coming here. We want to hang out with you to see how much we can be able to attract you and let you understand that it is possible for you to be here and participate in the NASSIT scheme way back home. It is possible for you to be here and be a member of NASSIT through the methods we have explained during some of our meetings. And if you go online and if you try to read some of the literature that have been written over the last 2 weeks, you can be a member of NASSIT. Contact the US Embassy here, it will be possible. And the last set of people those Sierra Leoneans that are here and they think that nothing is happening back home. I would like you to understand that there are avenues through which you can be able to participate in national development. We want to welcome your ideas. We want to encourage you to understand that we are just trying to develop. We will get there. We are way behind. But some of us have volunteered to stay home to make sure that we contribute to national development. Please, when you hear something that is negative to any institution in Sierra Leone, try to see how much you can make it good, how much you can tip in with your experience here. This is not your home. So, if you are facing problems whilst you are here and you are trying to develop back home in terms of owning a house, I would like to encourage you that we have brought products, good news for you, with HFC, the Home Finance Mortgage and Savings Company. You can actually own a house without going to Sierra Leone. You can buy a house at your comfort. You can avoid the risk of being duped by family members or being duped by other relatives. You know, you can make it happen through your participation. I think I will end here.
Okay, thank you very much, gentlemen. By the way, we were accompanied to the studios by two gentlemen who have also worked very hard to make sure that the NASSIT outreach in New Jersey is successful. We have Mr. Fode Mansare, a mortgage banker. He has been very helpful in helping to talk to people, to get people to come to the program, to the outreach program. And then we have Mr. Pavi Jalo. He has also worked very hard to make sure that this outreach is successful. Gentlemen, thank you very much for your efforts.
And before we leave, I'd like to say a special thank you to the ambassador, Bokoi K. Stevens, and the head of mission, Ambassador Conte, the coordinator for the diaspora office, Mr. Usman Conte, head of chancery, Aisha Sila, the first secretary, Fatmata Dawal, the press attaché, Pascal Temple, the drivers, Eric and Daniel, and all the organizing committees in Atlanta, in Columbus, Ohio, and in New Jersey, who have been very supportive and have helped to make this outreach a huge success. Thank you very much. We appreciate your help. We appreciate your efforts. And Kokorio Ko, not to forget, for the huge media coverage. And of course, the Reverend himself and our ambassador in the UN mission. They've been very supportive. And hopefully, we will be back. This is just an original outreach. This is just a pilot phase. And we will actually go. And hey, Mr. Amjet Jalomiba, my childhood friend. You know, back in when we were in school, I used to be at the principal's school, and they were at Albert's Academy. We known each other since those days when we were schoolboys in Freetown. We want to thank him for the good job he's doing in the United States. Nation building is tough. Not everybody can pack up and go in Freetown, but wherever you are, like my colleague said, you have a role to play. Be positive, be engaged. That's all we're asking. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
HJB Productions LLC. We are visual storytellers. We pride ourselves in taking your vision and converting them into visuals.